wooden frames. Here is an early shot of the construction of our parachute drying tower and the parachute packing facility. Sure was dusty in those days. And here is the tower in one of its later phases of construction. We turn now to an early parachute briefing. Note the fine facilities for the men to sit in. Our instructor, of course, was Captain Ellis. Ah, yes, those wonderful physical training conditioning drills. And those wonderful rope climbing towers. We're now on our way to another orientation. Here we're getting our first look at the chute close up and actually trying it on. One thing about the T5 parachute, it didn't matter whether you were short or tall, it always fit. Here we see the early mock doors. As close as can be expected to the actual door of the C-47 aircraft, which we came to know and love. We now witness an early loading of the aircraft for an orientation flight over Fort William Henry Harrison, to give us an idea of the training area and to let us get the feeling of an aircraft in flight. And here is the drying facility and packing facility when it was completed. We all remember that fatal day when we were first issued those chutes to make that first jump. Gee, I sure hope mine opens. And we were marched off to the airfield. This plane was to become a familiar sight to all of us. This one was called Geronimo and High Yaller. Here we are being broken up into sticks. Typical of the Army still today is hurry up and wait. And now, with the plane's motors finally turning over, we knew that shortly we would be in the air making that first jump. Here we see the wind speed and wind direction being read so that our plane will pass over the airstrip, allowing us to make safe landings in the surrounding area. This being our first jump, no one had ever told us just how hard these chutes would open. This was probably one of the softer landings ever made by a force member. And watch him collapse his chute using the bottom shroud lines as we were taught. Another one of the softer landings. Those of us who had the misfortune to have a panel come out of the chute were always lucky enough or happy enough to see that reserve open. We see here Lieutenants Wilson, Rosenstein, and Walker outside of the parachute issuing facility. We were being issued chutes this day before we made our second jump from the Helena Airport. And upon arriving at the airport to a large crowd of Helena citizens, we were formed up after equipment check. Boy, I sure hope this chute doesn't come off. Here we see Lieutenant Finn Roll, Captain Dave Hoskin and Lieutenant Bob Holt, boarding the plane for that second jump. Here we see our jump masters, Lieutenant LeBon and Lieutenant Stewart. Not all of us used perfect exit form, but we tried. And here, Lieutenant Stewart tells us we all made it out safely. And here is another successful opening of a reserve chute. Not all of our landings were pleasant ones. Here we see more men about to make some of those famous jumps over the Helena foothills. We believe most of these airborne shots were taken from the private plane of Colonel Frederick, the only known private plane in the area. Here is a beautiful shot. And this was a particularly rough landing. Here is Major John Bourne assisting a man with checking his equipment. Watch this narrow collision and escape. Some days the wind was quite bad. Here is an almost successful landing on the roof of the Post Theater. And on some of our not quite so good exits, we see We remember what we had to do. And we finally get that reserve shootout. It was a terrible predicament to be in, to realize that the main chute was not going to make it today, and that that reserve was needed. After a particularly bad, a man did require medical attention. It was not a pleasant sight to see one of our companions taken away in the meat wagon. Fortunately, on most of our landings, we survived. And here are the results of the shock of the opening of the T5 parachute.